morning session. First of all, I would like to invite our jury for introduce themselves. We work from Professor and I'm Jinghua Lu from NTNU. Okay, so let's introduce your team member from the reporter.
I'm the reporter of Team Progressive, and I'm the leader of Yu Jiawei. This is Sun Su, and this is the DC of Yu.
Like to challenge problem number four, colored line.
Problem number four.
We would like to accept the challenge.
Okay, so please write down your team member would like to present on the blackboard.
Thank you. introduction, part and the theory and agreement and the conclusion. And for Barbara's statement, we can see when a compact disc or DVD is illuminated with light coming from a filament lens in such a way that don't increase with dark angles or visibility or selected. A clear green line can observe the color varies up and slightly changing the angle of the disc. Explain and investigate this phenomenon. And we can see the key point from the proper statement is that what special with this or DVD to produce color lines and what makes various colors of light. And this is my observation video. As you can see, this is when I change the incline angle of the CD, and this is the observation video when I change the distance between the observer and the light source. And as you can see, there might be some curves, just like some angles between the lines, and we will explain it later. And so the point is the angle of the incline CD and the distance between the observer and the light. And there seems some little tricks on the CD circuit. We think they might be, related to the well, here's my theory part. And first, we're talking about the diffraction. The diffraction means when a light source goes through a switch, and when the lambda is more larger than the width of the wall, it will become diffraction. And when two diffraction waves run into each other, and they will either contract interference or another. So this is the diffraction grating. It's just like there will be bright and dark pattern when the interference occurs. And here's my theory. So here we can see, as I said, the line might be some angle. I think it's because of when I change the incline angle of the CD, the light reflected from P double prime will be changed into another direction. So there will be another angle of the lines on the CD surface. So, and we want to know what's going on the CD. So we calculate the electric field on the CD when our point P. And this is the electric field. And we sum up all of the electric field on the CD surface. Here comes the electric field equation. So because of that, the light intensity is proportional to E squared. So we will have a function like this to describe the relationship between the lambda and the intensity. So because we assume A over lambda cosine alpha, and we think the M will be related to the diffraction gratings, the interference pattern occurs. So when M is larger, the interference occurs further, so it will affect the result. So from the function over here, we can see the when the M is equals the integer, the intensity will be the largest. So we write down a function of wavelength and the largest intensity. This is the function. And this is when we consider only about the angle of alpha, where and the N A is the distance between the tracks. So when we consider about the inclined angle beta, we will have a function like this. So here is my experiment part. For experiment one, we want to make sure our CD or DVD, the distance between the tracks. So we made an experiment using the microscope, micrometer, to make sure the larger than CD, so the distance between the tracks will be smaller. And this is my experimental structure. As you can see, I can move the observer here and make sure the length between the distance between the CD and the observer and CD between the light source and calculate the cosine alpha with this function, and the data is measurable in our experiment. And this is my experiment devices. We use this single LED light for single direction LED light for our experiment, and this is the observer which comes from the spectrometer, and this is my chip, like CD or DVD. And this is how I measure the beta of the CD. So this is the light, and this is the speed which fits on the horizontal, fits on the verticals, and this is the disk. So I take a photo to measure the beta. And because of there are many types of light source, so we measure our intensity wavelength rate of the LED, which means spectrum. And as you can see, this is the original spectrum of the LED. And how I do my experimental data is that I take the, this is the example for my experimental data, and we will compare the intensity between the example and the original one. So we will draw down a intensity wavelength grid like this, and to measure the largest or the second one intensity, target intensity. And the reason why here will be to hit its largest value is that because within the, it's because the diffraction gradient, just like what I was talking about on the talk before. So just like in this case, this is when n equals 2, and this is when n equals 3, there will be two maximum intensity of wavelength. So this is my experiment 2. And the control variable is that alpha, just between the observer and light source, and beta, the inclined angle. And A is the track between the distance between the track. So the parameter of this experiment is M. Just like I want to make sure the M, how the M affects the result. So this is my dependent parameter, just the dependent. And as you can see, in this case, when M equals 1, the intensity will be larger, and the second one will be decreased, the third will be 2. So we can see that M will actually affect the result of the intensity. And the intensity decreases as the number of M increases. And this is my experiment 3. I changed the angle of alpha to see what alpha affects to the results. So the ones are the theoretical result, and the red ones are corresponding results. And the reason why there are only 10 degrees, 20 degrees, 30 degrees, 40 degrees, because that when it over 50 degrees, it will not be measured. I think that because it's over the range of the visible light, so I can't do the experiment. So I take only 4 values of it. And the experiment 4 is the same as the further one, just but the term means what becomes beta. And so in experiment 5, I did the difference between the CD and DVD. And the wavelength of CD will be larger than DVD. So this is my conclusion. There are many diffraction gradients on the surface of the CD and DVD. And the light reflected from the gradients to construct it interpret to make various colors. And when the constructed interference occurs when the n equals integer, and the phenomenon can be described as this function, and it's very closely to my experimental results. Thank you for listening.
Do we agree that the filament light is a continuous spectrum?
I think no. So I use LED light for my experiment.
Which part of light did you choose to analyze the fish yourself? The cell fish. You think that there are various kinds of color on the
light? Oh, difficult. It's so difficult.
I want to ask which part do you analyze?
And I want to explain that. It's because when I take the photo, there will be another light source to affect my photo. So, but when I turn off the light and
were there any differences when we use CD or DVD?
Yes.
Yes. Okay. Does the position of light source affect the experiment?
Yes.
How do you measure the wavelength of light?
Wavelength of the light, we use spectrometer.
Spectrometer. Okay. Can you prove that the light from the disk is monochromatic light? Monochromatic light, it means that it only contains one wavelength. It is not a composition of many wavelengths.
Yeah.
Can you prove this?
No, because you know.
Are there any boundary conditions in your experiment?
No.
Are there any limitations in your experiment, like if the tilt angle is too large, the phenomenon won't occur?
No, because I use these to make sure I can get the data.
Oh, and how do you turn the disk?
Turn the disk using this.
Okay, which part of why does the light reflect from the disk? Can you explain why?
Because it's smooth on the disk, so it might reflect.
Okay, I'll discuss it later. Turn to page 13. What does the access mean?
The axis means the value of n.
Okay, thank you. Turn to page 19.
Okay, time is up.
Thank you.
take the floor for your presentation.
Honorable juries and fellow competitors, I'm the opponent from Team Excelsior. Today I'm going to oppose problem number 4, colored line. Here's the problem statement. When a compact disc or DVD is illuminated with light coming from a filament lamp in such a way that only rays with large angles of incidence are selected, a clear green line can be observed. The color varies up and slightly changing the angle of the disc. Explain and investigate this phenomenon. And I think later we'll discuss the filament lamp part because this is what the problem statement has required. And we'll mainly focus on what caused the green line existing on the disc and how do different parameters affect the color of the line. For example, the rotating angle, the tilting angle of the disc, and how will different position of the observer affect the observation. Here is the outline of the reporter. In the theory part, they talk about the diffraction phenomenon of the light. Also the interference, describing how different same wavelength of light is compositioning and creating stronger intensity of light. And they also introduce the diffraction grating. In the explanation parts, they explain how different parameters affect the result. However, they lack of error analysis and no error bars in their experiment part. And for analysis, the parameters they change include the distance between the track. They change. They investigate the tracks, the length of the tracks of the CD and DVD, and compare the difference between these parameters. And they change the inclination angle beta of the disc. They also observe in different angles alpha between the observer and the disc. These are the strong and weak points of the reporter. We believe that they show clear observation video so that we can understand how the phenomenon occurred. However, they lack qualitative explanation about how the green light is formed and how the light is reflected from the CD. They try to explain the diffraction on the DVD and CD since that it is how the intensity of the light becomes stronger. They have detailed theoretical models so that we can prove that some of their hypotheses are correct. However, they did not consider several factors well, like the light pollution in their setup. They have considered a lot of parameters, which the opponent think that this is a great behavior, and they cannot avoid other lighting resources in his setup that I just mentioned. They also don't have any error analysis in their experiment. These are the points the opponent wants to discuss. First is about the qualitative explanation. We want to discuss why is there the formation of light. Since if there is a CD and the light comes from here, the light intends to reflect in an angle but not return from the disc. So I think that there is some reason that caused this phenomenon to happen. And the limitations, we believe that there are some limitations when the tilting angle is small. Limitation also includes interference and the wavelength of light. For experiment part, we believe that the reporter has not many parameters, but we still want to discuss how they actually affect the phenomenon. For a setup part, we believe that a more accurate setup can be set up by the reporter since there are some deviations in their experiment part. And for analysis, we want to investigate how the intensity, the wavelength, and the color on the disk will be changed by different parameters. And I want to skip to the next part. First, can you explain again how is the light reflected from the CD?
When the light hits the surface on the CD, it will reflect.
Can you explain how the direction works?
Just like when the light hits here, it will reflect back.
And you just set up each. That you like to apply that here and it will reflect that like this?
No, you will reflect. You will reflect in my case.
Well, reflect that. And can I use the backboard?
Yes.
In the process statement, we believe that the observed is that there are some structure on the CPU that forms the different ways to compile. And we believe that in order to page how you introduce the CD and DVD the tracks by 1,369 nanometers. Yes, we believe that can you preliminary explain why we should be about this? What is this to represent the number?
Results in the details.
beta angle increases, beta angle increases,
yes,
the cosine angle of the beta will be smaller, right? So, whenever beta angle increases, it means that the distance between these screens is smaller.
Okay.
This is L, and when the tilt angle of beta angle increases,
yes,
it means that the value will be smaller. This is the L and S up. So we need to do this. So Appleman believes that when the tilt angle of the beta angle increases, it means that the wavelength of this ring will decrease. This will result in the experiments they have. Blue light has the smaller wavelength in their environment. So the blue light in their experiments comes from the tilt angle of beta increase and closer the distance between the wavelengths. Okay, I want to set up it. The problem statement mentioned that there will be a line formed in the diameter of the disk. And why there is many lines on the disk, why there will be problems.
When I'm doing an experiment, there will only be one line. And the reason why there is a lot of different lines on the disk is because when I want to take a clear photo, I need to take on my life, so I can take a clear photo. So this is the reason why there are many different colors on it. But in my observation video, as you can see, I have only one line on the disk.
Okay, thank you. And it seems that there is a light reflecting from the lens using the capture. So have you tried the experimental result when you cover the environments and only let the light from the
No, because when I'm doing the experiment, I will turn off all the lights and make sure another light source will not affect my experiment. So I think there will not be much experimental error in my experiment.
The opponent also thinks that there should not be light pollution. And it comes into the results of your experiment. It is observed that the range from the 450 to 500 is intensity is from the right.
Yes.
And can you explain why the Harman statement mentioned that we need a green light? But there's the wavelength up there is the blue light.
Because we see the green light, but there is also blue light on it. If the color of it is pink, but the blue light is not on it.
There are more lights that was shown in the experimental results, and we believe that a prism can be used in the experiments.
Okay, time is up. Time is up. Yeah, please. Return your things and preparation for the opponent.
Honorable juries and fellow competitors, this is the discussion summary from the opponent. We believe that the formation of the green light is because the tracks of the CD reflect the light, and so that it's the the observer can observe the green light from the refraction of the track. And we believe that the structure of DVD and CD will cause the differences, the length of differences between the tracks and affect the experimental results. And the experimental setup should be improved because it seems that there are some light pollution in their experiments. So we believe that light should be covered to prevent some deviations. And we believe that the reporter should analyze their experimental results with the prism so that the result of their lights coming through the prism, it will be split into several wavelengths so that they can analyze the result from the
wavelength. Thank you. Reviewer, please take the floor.
The distance between your light and the disk is the same. We don't need to measure it because I
when we move the light source, the light and the distance will change. Do you think that it should be a control variable?
I think the factor that only affects the experimental result is the diameter of the disk with the and the angle between the observer will affect actually.
Okay, so your answer is
okay.
And the second question is, how does the VESA angle affect the color that we see, and how does that refer to your theory?
In my theory, you can see there is a function over here. So when beta increases, the value of lambda prime m will be decreased. So in my experiment,
okay.
In my experiment, the beta also decreases.
Okay. So right now your experiment is turning your this like this. Can you please predict what will happen if you turn your angle like this?
I mean, why is there only three values of it? Because in this case, I can only take the three values to get.
Can you please predict what will happen if you turn your disk? Like right now, you're turning your disk. Can you please predict what will happen if you turn your disk? Like there's another.
In what way from here to here?
Yeah.
From here to here? The color will change.
We believe that the phenomenon happens when the light from here reflects, and there's an angle between the disk, so that the track can reflect the light. So if we turn the disk in this angle, we believe that the lights can reflect from the disk because there is not an inclination angle here. So yes.
Extensions possible. And for their theoretical analysis, they talked about the diffraction, interference, diffraction grating. And for their experimental confirmation, they talked about the disk angle, light distance, and the difference between CDs and DVDs. Next to the mirrors and complementary steps of the reporter. Firstly, for their theory, they had a very detailed theoretical model and good theoretical considerations, but they could improve on the qualitative explanation of the fermions since they have the lack of an explanation to the formula. And for their experiment, they have sufficient experimental data, but they could improve on the difference between theoretical and experimental verification since there are no deviations investigated and they have a lack of analysis and theoretical match. And for their structure, they had good diagrams and animation, which are good for the audience's visualization. And for the opponent, their merit was they had clear thoughts and questions and summarized the reporter's presentation well. And they extended discussions of the experiment, for example, the tilting angle and the viewing angle. And they identified merits and flaws of the presentation. And the possible next steps, they could investigate the different tilting angle. So next is about the discussion analysis. So the opponent raised that when light hits the side of the track, it reflects back. And the reporter's response was, the light reflects on the CD and DVD. And we disagreed with the reporter since the opponent's opinion explains the phenomenon better and it's more clarified and verified by his. And next is the tilt angle measurement. The opponent raised that the tilt angle will increase means the wavelength decreases, but the reporter didn't have sufficient answer and explanation of that question. Next is the light pollution. So in their picture, it shows that there are many light pollution. The easy example is that the light reflects on the desk, and they did turn off their lights when they did their experiment. And but the reporter's response was they had sit in a black room. And we agree with the reporters. The reporter has stated multiple times that they did an experiment in a black room. And the question from the reviewer is that the distance between the light is the distance between the light and the disk the same? And the opponent's answer was that that's not a very important factor. And the reporter's response was, it's not needed to calculate, but we disagree with the reporter because we think that it would have an impact on the phenomenon and should be determined with more experiments specifying it. Next is what will happen if we turn the disk angle into a different axis. And the opponent's response was the light can't be reflected, and the reporter's response was the color will change. And that's the end of my presentation. Thank you.
Concluding remark from the reporter.
First, I want to thank the opponent and the reviewer to take their opinion to my agreement. And the first I want to mention about is that the constructive wave and diffraction grating, which the opponent had mentioned, I think that when M, which means A over lambda cosine alpha, which when it is in an integer, then it will be constructive interference. The reason is that when the value is an integer, the shape will be matched from the original one, so there will be a constructive interference. And in my experiment, the opponents keep asking about the experimental light, but I have mentioned in my experiment setup for a lot of times, so I think it can be focusing on the other experimental results of my dream rather than talking about the theory in the opinion. And that's all. Thank you very much.
Okay, now it's a question time from jury.
Experiment data undertaken with the subgroup is your result. Is your theoretical
result and the corresponding result?
Yes, undertaken is consistent. just answer yes or no.
Yes.
If yes, you're using the wavelength of the green, the laser light?
The LED.
LED light, okay. All the CD and DVD, they have a vacuum coating on their surface. Does this coating affect the result?
Can you say that
again? All the CD and DVD, they have a vacuum layer coating on the surface.
Coating?
Coating on the surface. So what would this result affect your experimental result?
I don't really understand what is coating.
Coating is you put something on top of it.
I will hear the CD or the DVD being.
So you cannot consider the coating?
Yes, because I hear.
The opponent believes that only the tracks, the bumping parts of the on the CD or DVD will reflect the light from the light source. So it's the only parameters that affect the formation of the light is the track.
So the coding won't change in the number?
I don't think so.
So how about the review of this?
I think that
you should know that the light in different media, they have different wavelengths. The number will change.
Okay. Any other questions?
Question for the opponent. If you apply a light with a single wavelength, say, right laser, will you still see the same phenomenon?
Oh, if you just provide the light to this
blue light laser, just single wavelength.
If the incident light is only one color, one wavelength.
There will only be the light from. There will not be the green light, but it will be the light from the laser.
Yes,
the
laser.
Color of light from the laser.
Okay. Can reviewer answer?
We believe that the blue light will only be visible in a certain angle, but the other colors will be present.
Okay, so when you see the green line?
No.
I got a question for three of you. If you fix beta and the position of the light source, is there a specific angle of alpha to see the green light? Start from the point.
Yes, in my example of the experiment, you can see the green line, like here will be a maximum wavelength of LED.
May I explain it on the when the angle is more like 0 to 20 degrees, the light from the light source reflecting from the.
I was asking any specific angle of alpha to see the green light?
Oh, I'm sure that the 15 angle will definitely produce the green light.
We believe that there is green light at a specific
angle. Specific angle, maybe?
Any other question from jury? I have a question for the opponent. When you shine the light on your CD or DVD, you mentioned that the reflected light will be like that directly back to the light source, or just go follow the reflection law?
When the light is when light comes from here, it will definitely reflect to the opposite angle of the light source. But we believe that the phenomenon caused because the track on the CD will cause the direction to be different. Because when there is no track, when light comes from here, it only reflects here to there. But if there is a track on the CD, it will reflect to the observer.
Okay. How about reporter's point of view?
Can you
When the light shines on the CD or DVD, the opponent mentioned that the light may be reflected back to the light source, not only to the follow the reflection law. What's your opinion?
I think there might be some specific phenomenon on it, but I think that will not be the most part of the problem.
Okay, how about
both of the happen, but we think that the light that reflects back is more important to this.
Reflect back is more important. But follow the reflection low or back to the light source?
Both will happen, but we think that the one that reflects back reflects is
more. Okay. Now it's scoring time for jury.
Thank you.
reporter, please tell the floor.
I'm the world jurist and fellow competitors. I'm the reporter from Peking South here. Today I'm going to report problem number 8, Euler's pendulum. Problem statement. Take a thin plate of non-Euler's magnet and suspend the human magnet on top of it. Suspend rods underneath it, and which can be assembled from the human magnet. Deflect the rod so that it touches the plate only with the highest edge. Investigate the motion of such a pendulum under various conditions. And you'll mainly focus on what are the forces acting on the pendulum and how do different parameters affect the motion of the pendulum. This is our outline. First, we're going to talk about our preliminary experiment, including the observation ratio and quantitative explanation. Next, we'll have the theoretical model about how we calculate magnetic force and friction. And we'll get the equation of motion through our laboratory equation. In the experiment part, the parameters we check include the initial angular velocity, magnitude, friction, and pendulum length. Next, we'll have the conclusion. Experimental setup. This is our setup. As you can see, the pendulum magnet is suspended underneath the top magnet. And this is the class space that the problem statement mentioned. And the stage will spin so that it gives the pendulum initial angular velocity. And the motor will spin the stick, right? And this is the advantages of our setup. We have constant angular velocity for the pendulum so that it has stabilized kinetic energy. And also we can stabilize the initial tilting angle because we can investigate how the pendulum acts, starts at 90 degrees, 60 degrees, or 30 degrees. Preliminary experiments. This is the observation video when we recorded from the top of the pendulum. We can see that the x chart of the pendulum, this is the x chart of the pendulum. The amplitude of this chart symbolized the distance between the edge of the pendulum to the center of the top magnet. And we can see that during the end of the spinning, it has increased frequency. It means that its angular velocity is increasing. And the theta part means that the angle of the pendulum will gradually decrease. It means that it is experiencing a dropping motion. This is my quantitative explanation. First, I want to analyze the system in the force analysis. The main forces acting on the system are magnetic force and friction, and inclement. And you can divide the magnetic force into the vertical component and the horizontal component. The vertical component works against gravity so that the pendulum will not go down and creates no more force between the pendulum and the plate. So there will be friction between, a kinetic friction between the pendulum and the plate. And the horizontal part, it provides centripetal force for the pendulum so that it can have circular motion. And we know that the magnetic force gradually increases when tilting angle decreases because the magnets are getting closer. And the friction acting on the system includes kinetic friction and rolling friction. Note that rolling friction won't dissipate any energy and will cause the pendulum itself to rotate. And we still want to analyze the pendulum, the system in the energy part. When theta equals to zero, that means that it has minimum potential energy. As a result, when we release the pendulum from theta, when theta equals to 90 degrees, its theta equal gradually decreases and its potential energy will transform into kinetic energy. And the dissipation part including sliding between the pendulum and the plate, air drag, and in the boundary part, the pendulum will collide with the plate. And eventually, the theta angle equals to zero. Theoretical model. This is how we analyze the magnetic force between the magnets. First, we can consider the magnet seems to the south pole and north pole in this situation. And by measuring the magnetic flux density of different distance, we can calculate the magnetic moment and the distance between these nodal poles in the magnets. As a result, we can calculate the forces between magnets quantitatively. And this is the chart we test the magnetic force and calculate it to our track the position of the magnet using tracker. As a result, we can get the acceleration of the magnet. So by calculating, they get the kinetic friction coefficient between the magnets and the face. And these are the kinetic friction coefficients we need to measure, including glass, gas with oil, and different kinds of tin tubers. Next, if we want to calculate the frictional function through the Laplace equation, we have to get the kinetic energy of the pendulum first. We define the radius of the pendulum as r, and the length of the pendulum is d, by getting its x, y, z position. And in every component, we can get the velocity of the pendulum. And this is the transitional kinetic energy of the Laplace equation. We also need to consider the rotational energy of the pendulum, since that the pendulum will have a tilting angle theta, and the revolution angle big phi, pendulum phi, and the pendulum itself will rotate an angle. We call it small phi. So this is the momentum of the inertia of the pendulum. For the potential energy part, we have to consider the rotational energy and magnetic potential energy. Note that the potential energy, we consider the energy between the S4 of the pendulum and S4 of the top magnets. And there are four potential energy in our experiments. For a normal force part, we get an acceleration of the pendulum in the Z component and calculate the normal force. For dissipation, we use this equation to calculate the dissipation of the system. Note that the V equals to the upper rim, the spinning speed of the upper rim at the contacting point. And by calculating the equation, we can get the result. These are equations of the motion of the pendulum. Note that the theta angle is the decreasing angle. The big phi angle is how the pendulum rotates, and the small phi angle is the self-rotation of the pendulum. This is our boundary condition. When the angular velocity of the pendulum is too fast, it will fly out of the top magnets. So when centrifugal force is bigger than centripetal force, the revolution won't exceed. That's what we want to see. And when the initial angular velocity of the pendulum is too low, it will directly collide on the plate, and we define this as a Bell deviation. And the others are the susceptible rotation in our definition. First, our first experiment is about the initial angular velocity of the pendulum. We divide, when the angular velocity of the pendulum is too small, we divide it into three stages. The first, and when the angular velocity is not enough, it will decline its theta angle initially and transform potential energy into kinetic energy, so that its angular velocity increases. And it will experience a steady dissipation since it's becoming in a balanced situation. And in the final part, it has increased angular velocity because the magnets get closer, so the centrifugal force is bigger. This is another situation where the angular velocity isn't enough. When the angular velocity is enough, we can solve the denting part. However, if the angular velocity is too fast, its centrifugal force is so fast that it won't decline this theta angle. So it will dissipate its kinetic energy at 90 degrees until it doesn't have enough kinetic energy so that it starts to drop down. And this is, we charge the theta angle of time of the, when the initial angular velocity is too fast, we can find that the theta angle is directly on 90 degrees and starts to decline after this position. And this is the inaccuracy of the kinetic friction coefficient measurement. And the thinking, the definition at this part is because the initial tilt of the pendulum. Next, we change the magnetic field intensity of the top magnet. We can find out that when the intensity is stronger, it means that the top magnets can stick to the pendulum stronger so that it is not less easily for the pendulum to fly out. For the friction part, if we have the larger kinetic friction coefficient, you can measure that its duration, the spinning time of the pendulum will decrease because the dissipation of the energy becomes more significant. And when the kinetic friction increases, it does not affect the boundary condition because it is not included in centripetal force, neither the centrifugal force. When we change the pendulum length, although we change the length and the magnetic force between the magnets, we can still find the tendency of the experiment. top magnet stronger. So that's this boundary condition, it can swing to the higher speeds and it won't be disconnected. Note that when the length of the pendulum increase, the duration it spins will be longer. Conclusion. This is how we analyze the experiment. For the periodic time of the rotation, we tested the rotation time, repeated many times, and got the average time. For angular velocity part, we believe that we can use trackers to track the position. And the theta angle over time, we can use that calculation to get the theta angle using arc sine theta. And how does the phenomenon occur? It means the vertical forces include gravity and magnetic potential energy to the magnet, and its magnetic force and the horizontal component will provide centripetal force. That's like I mentioned here. And friction is the main dissipation in this system. And how do different parameters affect the motion of the pendulum? We believe that greater potential angular velocity will have different slope of omega, as I just mentioned, and they have different duration. Greater monopoles means that the stronger, the magnet is stronger, so that it's more difficult to disconnect it with the magnet. For stronger friction coefficient, it means that you will experience faster dissipation. And for greater pendulum lengths, it has increased duration and greater maximum, maximum omega.
A question from the opponent.
So, can you explain what is the difference between the normal pendulum and this mechanical pendulum?
Can you rephrase your question again?
Can you explain the difference between a normal pendulum and a mechanical and a U.S. pendulum?
When we calculate the equation of motion, we have to consider the potential energy of magnetic potential energy. Also, we have to define the normal force caused by the magnetic force.
Okay, has the force snipping ever occurred to you?
Can you rephrase?
The snipping, has it ever occurred to you?
Yes, in the whole rotation, the snipping occurs.
Okay. So, do you think the circular pendulum motion that has a difference to a normal two-dimensional?
When you mean the swinging motion?
Yeah.
Oh, we believe that the main dissipation of the rotation motion is the kinetic friction between the pendulum and the plate. And for the swinging part, we believe that when the pendulum collides with the plate, it will have more dissipation. So the main dissipation is different in the swinging part.
What does this circular motion make it different from the normal two-dimensional?
We believe that the rotational motion is the extensive situation for the pendulum. We believe that we have to calculate centripetal force and centrifugal force in the rotation.
Okay.
Thank you.
please take the floor.
Good morning, Judge Chantel. I'm the opponent from the and today I'm opposing the question neural pendulum. So this is a problem that we take a non-magnetic material and fix a neural magnet on top of it, and we suspend a magnetic rod. And underneath it, and the rod, so it touches only with higher spin, and we study the motion of this magnetic rod. And the reporter's presentation, they observe the frequency of the pendulums at different parameters. Their series is the different magnetic forces, the kinetic friction, the rolling friction, and the potential energy. And in their data analysis, they analyze their initial spinning speed, their magnetic field intensity, and their friction and their pendulum bends. Yeah, here are some of the pros and cons of the reporter. First, at a series section, the reporter, they have a detailed explanation and a good theoretical consideration and a qualitative explanation of the phenomenon. In the experiment, they have a stable experiment setup and sufficient experiment data and theoretical verification. There are also something they could improve on. For example, in the experiment, they have back up the deviation investigated. And also, they could add more points for exact characterization. And finally, in their experiment, they could verify more different parameters. For example, the amount of magnets on top and on the bottom of the tape. Yeah, so here are some of the questions I would like to discuss later on the discussion period. First is the experiment setup, and the second is the amount of magnets both on top and on the bottom. And third is the thickness of the tape. And finally is some of the errors in the experiment. Yes. And I would like to continue on to the discussion period. First I would like to discuss with you about the amount of your magnets. Like, have you ever thought about how the amount of magnets on the top of the table or on the bottom of the table would affect the result of the experiment?
And can I answer your question separately?
Yeah.
Experiments. When the top magnet is stronger, it means that attractive force between the magnets is stronger too. So it means that it has stronger normal force. So the duration of the spinning time will be shorter because the normal force is stronger, the kinetic friction will be stronger as well. So the dissipation will be more significant. For the boundary condition part, we believe that because the top magnet is stronger, it means that the attracting force is stronger too. So that we can accelerate the pendulum to a higher speed, that it still won't be disconnected. And for the lower part of the pendulum, the magnets, we believe that if the length of the pendulum is stronger, it means that the momentum of the inertia will be stronger too, because the mass of the object is stronger too, the revolution, the R. M R omega squared. The revolution radius of the pendulum will be stronger too. So we believe that the longer the pendulum is, the rotation, the rotational time, will, the stronger it will be.
And how about lower magnets? Like, since you said you're wanting to discuss it separately.
I think I just finished my explanation.
So there's also another parameter I have discussed, which is the amount of the non-magnetic plates in between the two magnets.
The amount of?
The non-magnetic plates in between.
Oh, you mean the thickness of the
plates?
Yeah, yeah. Oh, I think I didn't conduct this experiment, but I can explain this phenomenon to you. We believe that if the plate is, there are more plates, it means that the magnetic force will decrease. So that the spinning time will increase and the magnetic force between the surfactants will decrease too. But if there are still plates, we could allow probably that the phenomenon will still occur. Now the video shows that even if there's no place between this the downward parts, pendulum and the upper parts, the phenomenon can still occur.
So in your current part, there's a section where you discuss about the initial rotation of the rod itself. And how would that affect your experiment? The rod itself is spin. Like the initial rotation.
This?
Yeah.
Oh, we believe that in the initial part, because the pendulum is faster in the initial part, so there is mainly kinetic friction between the pendulum and the plate. But as time progress and the tilted angle decrease, we believe that there will be rolling friction between the pendulum and the plate, so that rolling friction will cause the pendulum itself to rotate. So there is not a parameter considering the rotating angle of the pendulum itself initially.
So, can you predict what will happen if you change the different radius of the magnets both on top and on the bottom?
Both on top and the bottom.
Like answer these questions separately, like on the top and on the bottom.
On the top of the magnet, if the radius remains, you need to change the radius.
Yes.
Does the magnitude of monopoles change? Like the magnetic force becomes
stronger?
No, it doesn't change.
No.
So we believe that the radius, even if the radius change, the duration of the spinning time will still remain constant. But can you use the background to explain?
Yes.
Gradually gradually take all of the digits and eventually you will be agreeing at this point. So I think there really is a difference. It will be the track of the other being different.
So I want to ask, how did you release your map?
This is how we release the pendulum. First, we use our head to make sure we have an initial tilting angle. Then we elevate the lifting table to maintain this tilting angle so that initially it looks like this. And we have the motor to accelerate the rotating speed of the pendulum to give it initial kinetic energy so that until it has the speed we want to measure, we can release the stage so that the pendulum itself can have its motion on the plates. Yes.
So you mean basically you let the magnets on the bottom spin out on itself? Like when it spins to the speed you want, you just put down the stage and let it spin out.
Yes.
So in this kind of release method, there will be some like errors happen when you release the stage. So how do you restrict those errors?
Can you explain why the deviation is caught in this situation?
Like when it goes down, the stage it might grab onto the magnet and pulls it down a little bit, or the gravity could take hold and lets releasing and let it stay on. Based on
top
of
the
stage, and that's it, releasing will be a little shorter.
We believe that, you see that here is a U-shaped disk that will hold the pendulum and make it accelerate like this. And when we release the plate, the U-disk only drop down directly, so it's the deviation part, it won't affect that much.
So in your tracking, you track the head of the pendulum, right?
The edge of the pendulum.
Yeah. What do you think what happens? You also track the top end, which is connecting with the magnet.
You mean track the contacting point?
Yes.
I think we can get the same angular velocity, but the different actually chart.
Like how would it be different?
How would it be different? The angular velocity will remain the same because the angular velocity of being kept off by angle, like the revolution angle like this, the edge point and the upper rim part, the angular velocity will remain the same.
So first I want to ask the reporter, is there a decay of energy?
array of energy, you mean the dissipation?
Yes.
We believe that there are mainly three kinds of dissipation energy. First is the kinetic pressure between the pendulum and the plate.
You don't have to tell me what state of energy depends on.
Aircraft collision, okay. Kinetic friction.
Then where do I see these in your theoretical results?
We did not consider collision part because we believe that the problem state dimension only at higher stage, so we did not consider the collision parts. And the kinetic friction part, we believe that we calculated the dissipation parts in our kinetic friction, also like here and here in the last stage.
And then next, the third one.
Air drag, we believe that the main dissipation is kinetic friction. So the air drag will be that significant.
And do you agree with the reporter on his three? Please And so I'll first talk about the pros and cons of the reporter. So the pros is that the reporter had a clear outline and a clear experiment setup and observation videos. He also had very clear images to explain the theory. And the cons are the reporter did not have quantitative comparison between the theory and experiments, such as errors, and also the lack of discussion of energy decay, considering many parameters. And then he also did not explain the curves of the graph. And also there are some axes that he didn't explain. But for the opponents, the opponent had well understanding of the phenomenon while also focusing on the reporter's structure of the presentation. And he asked very precise problems for the theoretical analysis. But for the opponent, he did not ask the problems about like answering the reporter, and he also lacks discussions of experimental details. And so the missed points of both that the initiating of the experiment is actually, there is actually a flaw to it, that the rod touches the top of the board with infinite points, exactly the one. And so first the opponent asked, how do you release the magnets? And the reporter asked, using the motor to have an initial velocity and using hand to have initial angle. And I do think that this is a good way to release the magnets. But the thing that needs to be considered is the contact with the top plates. And also the opponent asked, when spinning the speed you want, do you just release it? And the reporter answer is yes, and I do agree that you can just release it, since there will be no more normal force with the contact of the plate. And also, the opponents and the reporter discussed about how the releasing and changing the radius and the amount of magnets on the blackboard there. And I do believe that these are very important parameters to be discussed. And so then I asked, factors do the decay of energy depend on, and to show it in the theoretical results. The reporter answered air drag, friction, and collision, while he only discussed about friction in his theoretical results. And the opponents answered that the air drag should be ignored, yes, but the collision should be considered. And I also asked, what are your theoretical assumptions? And the reporter's answer was only the mono points of the rod, and opponent answered there should be also other theoretical assumptions. And I asked, does your angular velocity change? And the reporter's answer is yes, and opponent said yes, but I wanted to see it in your theoretical results. Does the magnetic force in the equation mean a scalar or a vector? And the reporter's answer was a vector, and same as the opponent's. And I agree with it being a vector. So then I asked, will adding or changing the magnets be a good way to change only one parameter? And the reporter's answer is, it can't be viewed as only changing one, while the opponent asked, said that he already discussed about it. And I do think that this changes a lot of parameters at once, so there has to be another way to fix it. So thank you. This is my first
question. Our work groups and fellow competitors, this is my concluding remark. First, for reporter, we have mentioned that the question marks in our report is the technical problem of changing power point from one computer to another. This does not affect the reports our affect the results of our report. And curving line part, we believe that that is the theory after we calculate the theoretical model and we have numerical solution through our Python simulation. So we can get the curved line. For the equation of motion for Lagrange equation are calculated by ourselves, and these are the results we calculated. If you are interested in the results, we can discuss after the round. And so we didn't have any derivation in our its calculating part. And there is no consideration for rotating friction and in the initial condition because it does not exist. When changing the radius of the magnetic force, the duration of the spinning time will still remain constant as magnetic force is the same too. And using the releasing method to the table of the of this we give the initial angle and we just release it. Different parts of the pendulum relates the same angular velocity when they change the magnetic field. The change of the decay of energy is caused by magnetic friction, air drag, and the collision. We believe that if the reviewer still wants to add the air drag part in the equation of motion, we can get a fitting constant, e fitting constant, and a speed square at the end of the equation of motion to consider air drag. And as we mentioned in the report, the magnetic force will change when magnets increase the. When we change the length of magnets, it will increase the magnetic force. But I think this is inevitable.
Okay, now it's time for
questions from George. Can you explain the equation of the magnetic force? The magnetic force.
Magnetic force.
Magnetic force. You're okay. Magnetic force.
Yes. How we calculate magnetic force?
Yes. This is monopole force. So the interaction between the magnet is the monopole or dipole.
Can you rephrase again?
The force you are writing is the monopole source. But for the magnetic field, is it the monopole interaction force or dipole interaction?
I think there is a different point of view for considering the magnetic field, and we believe that this is just one way. The other way we have considered is magnetic field.
So it should be a force or a torque you see the change of motion.
This is just the magnetic field and how we calculate the force and energy.
So how about your opponent's opinion? Should it be a monopole force or a dipole force?
We think it should be a magnet force.
Monopole force or dipole force?
Dipole force.
Then their equation is wrong.
Right.
Do you mean that?
We think that it is the equation is able to explain the phenomenon in some sections, but we see the more accurate.
Okay.
Is
what do you do? Do you think that you're using the force to analyze or torque to analyze?
I think that's the magnetic force assumption has some flaws to it, since he didn't describe why it was a monopole or a dipole. And to me, I believe that it is a dipole, so that equation would have some flaws.
So the induction should be work or
Sorry?
The induction should be analyzed using the force to analyze or torque to analyze.
Analyze with?
The interaction.
Force
or torque?
The magnetic force works on the center of mass, so I don't think it's a torque, it's a force.
Can you help for the distortion? Can you turn to page 6 of your presentation? Alright, so you consider the top one, the top figure, you consider frequencies, alright? And you mentioned frequency was increased. Do you plot the frequency as a function of the time?
We just not plot it, but I can explain that when it experiences an amplitude, it means that it rotates what? So the angular velocity can also express the frequency of the x charts as well.
Okay, because I'm wondering if you plot the product of omega squared, which is the frequency, and the amplitude, which is the x. Okay, I just want curious when you increase or decrease as a time of, as a function of the time.
Oh, I understand.
Okay,
thank you.
I got a question for the reporter. On your schematic, you show there's only one contact point between the top magnet and the lower block. But after it starts to oscillate or something, whatever, what about the contact point? Is that all fixed or changed?
The contact point between the
the magnetic, the fact that the law, magnetic
law. What does that change for the,
I don't know, just give it a shot. So what, if that's true, the contact form is not fixed, was that taken into account in your calculation?
Of course.
Which one is that?
In this part, we calculate the mean is the speed of the top of the rim. So we consider the dissipation is the contact point between the point multiplies the speed of the contact point multiplies the friction.
Was you able to verify this phenomenon? I mean, through your experiment.
What do you mean?
Was you? I mean, because if you change the diameter of the magnetic block, you should be able to see this effect. Right? Because the contact form changes.
Right.
So if you change the diameter of the lower magnetic block, it will tell you something.
Believe that the upper rim only experience circular motion, the contact form only experience circular motion on the pendulum. So the diameter of the pendulum doesn't really affect because it's the track it walks on the plate will affect the dissipation.
Okay.
Very short question. But increasing the frequency, do you think it's the conservation of energy or conservation of environment?
Because it's the
energy or angular momentum. Just pick one.
It's a conservation of energy or
angular
momentum.
We believe that it's the conservation of energy.
We agree with the reporter on this.
Yeah,
it's
still
conservation.
No. We believe that it's the rotational moment. Yes.
Okay, now it's
boring time.
Please write down your member name.
with our main focus will be that we've been testing the periodic time of energy transfer between the two rulers. Second, we'll be talking about the displacement of the two identical leaf springs featured in the above statement. So this is our lahama. So in our observation, we'll be talking about the phases of movement, which we'll be using here in the picture. And we'll be talking about the movement prediction, is how we're going to predict the movement of our the two leaf springs. And the theory, we'll be using two theories, which one is the simple harmonic motion, and the second will be coupled oscillators. So first is our observation video. So this is a slow motion version of our coupled oscillator, which we can see that when our first, which is when our first leaf spring hits our second leaf spring, you will cause them both to oscillate after one another. So we can see that the second ruler repeated above and come to rest after the first stop oscillates, which is what we see in the slow motion video. So then we're going to be talking about the phases of movements that we see in the observation video. So first, I draw the pictures of the movement that I observed on the video into eight different pictures, which four is our initial four, and the second after this displacement is gradually stabilized. So the first ruler, because in the first four, we separate into the first four in the second half, is because the first ruler is vented, so it has the greatest elastic force initially. And then it pushes the ruler number two, so that the number two experiences the most elastic and repulsion force. And the both elastic force are in the same direction, which comes to feature number four right here. And then the last two is talking about that when they both have an acceleration, because as if we talk about this first picture, we can see that only the ruler number one has an elastic force, which is causing an acceleration. But if we're talking about the second picture, we can see that both one and two have their own acceleration. So that's why we use two different sets of pictures to describe the motion. So these are the corresponding movements that happen in the slow motion video to the corresponding movement that we use to explain the phenomenon. And this is the corresponding moment for the displacement and gradually stabilized section. So here we'll be talking about the displacement of the ruler. And because if we try to graph the displacement of the ruler, we will be making a graph like this. The two rulers are put together, and we can see that when one ruler has the largest displacement, the other one will have a smaller displacement, which is because one of them has a greater amount of energy. And the energy transfer from one another, that's what causes the T-spot differentiation in the displacement. And we can see that if the red wave is the elastic force, and the other wave, which is the green wave, is the magnetic force, we can see that there is a decline in motion, coefficient constant k. And we can see that when a red has a peak, then the green wave has its own trough, which we can see that when an elastic force reaches peak, then the magnetic force will reach its lowest point. So then we'll be talking about the bending, which there will be a small assumption. We make a small assumption because for the small deflection, the angle which we will define as angle that is smaller than phi, which the angle will be right here, will be defined right here. And if you can see that our force will be nearly like the spring force. And if we're counting for larger deflection, then it will look something much more like the bottom. So first, we'll be talking about our first theory. So the first theory is about, as we learned before, if the corresponding to the theory of simple harmonic motion, an ideal condition, it may look like the left picture. But we didn't see when we track the dots, or as the way we see it beforehand, we will see that it doesn't look like a clean sine wave. It will have a coefficient of the decline, or we can call it the bend. So that means if we include the resistance, it will be looking like a wave like this, which the peak will be decreasing over time. And if we consider the resistances, the ST graph in shape of something looks like this, which the A is the amplitude of the first, and the omega and the gamma is the and the gamma and the small n it is the coefficient, and the a is the period. So here we'll be doing the magnetic, we'll be talking about the magnetic force. So as we learned before the magnetic propulsion force, we can think as an inverse proportional to the square of the distance. But we need to use the experiment to see if it's actually true. So in the experiment, we use the vehicle to track the corresponding movement and the force that the device is measured. And at the right graph, we can see that the graph is log. It has a value similar to -2, which is connected to our theory. So this is the graph that we track when we are pushing the thing downwards. And then if we track the magnetic force to the distance, we can see that the slope, when we fit the line to all these dots, we can see that the slope is nearly -2.118, which fits our theory, which is it is -2, tower to -2. So our second theory is the coupled oscillations. So connecting the collapsing force with the magnetic, it can be seen as a coupled oscillator, like what we see on the left-hand side. And because both of the equation of the movement included the magnetic force in the movement of the ruler, so the magnetic force can transfer the energy to another ruler, which we can see as a coupled oscillator. Which in the video or in the GIF picture on the left, we can see when we strand two pendulums on a single string, we can see that the free motion also affects the red pendulum motion. That means they are not separate pendulums anymore, and they will be affecting one another from then on, which the function will be something like this. So then we'll be talking about our experimental setup. So first we will see that the green background is used to track the distance, and the ruler, we use aluminum ruler because if we use a metal or a metal attractive ruler, it might affect the experiment, and the magnet while oscillating might stick to the other ruler, causing a failed experiment to happen. And we use two sensors right here to track the distance of the oscillation. And the 4 centimeter here is what determined by the function that we need to be smaller than 5 degrees. So here we'll be talking just about the spring constant. By tracking the graph, we can see that the spring constant is nearly -0.1643, which can be determined like in this way. So today now we're talking about our variables. So the first variable is we'll be talking about the control variables are 1 and 2. And the independent variables that we're going to talk about is the distance from the magnet to the base. Second is the distance between the two identical leaf strings. And our dependent variables are talking about periodic time and the displacement. So first we're going to set out the distance. Well, the sensor data, we're going to transfer to centimeter, because the system data doesn't match up with centimeter as expected. So we have to do a transfer. So for the adjustment, we align the dot and with a real length, and then we smile it out like this, with a linear motion, linear like that. And with the experiment, the magnetic influence, we can see that the original without the magnetic, we can see that it has an equilibrium position at 5 centimeters. And the orange gets with the magnetic, you can see the equilibrium position is much closer to the sensor, causing a 4.8 centimeter. So if we only look at the first ruler, we can see that the equilibrium position is at 4.8 centimeters as we estimated. And if we add, and if we're talking about the period, you can see that in the end, when it starts to get into a stable moment, we can see that the period is almost the same. And then when we're talking about the second displacement, which in the equilibrium position we can see is nearly 5 centimeters. So then we're going to be talking about the R1 and R2 graph. So first we'll be talking, if we're really seeing the energy transfer right here, and if we added a second graph onto it, we can see that energy transfer is not very obvious. So the conclusion we can see that the displacement of the two streamlets is taking turns oscillating, while energy between them gradually decreases. And the displacement between the two rulers have a smaller periodic time at first, time of energy transfer, which is 1.834. After stabilized, the periodic time is merely at 2.338. And the life of the pendulum, the frequency is higher with the length of it, to the magnitude is shorter. And it can be explained by the pendulum. And four, the magnetic force influences the equilibrium position of oscillation more than the period of the oscillation. In our discussion, we're going to be talking about the different periodic time initially, but by the shorter time right here, is it because of error or some other factors? And that's the end of my conclusion.
So, I want to ask you some short questions. So first, what are your main parameters?
Main parameter is the magnet applied to the base and the distance between the two piece strings.
And so, have you ever considered that your experimental setup using your hand is not that precise?
We have thought about that, but we controlled it by using the, because we pulled it to the same, like 4 centimeters. So we can actually, we will know, because we tracked it onto the board, we will know that at least our release is nearly at the same spot, which means the error will be very minimal.
And are there any boundary conditions for the motion?
Boundary conditions? We did it because our angle is limited in between five degrees, so I can assure that between 5 degrees there is no boundary limit.
And why did you limit it to only 5 degrees?
Because right here.
Then for larger deflection, your form how calculated are your formula? And even if you have a formula, why did you use it?
Can you explain it?
So you only focused on angles less than 5 degrees, but you have a formula for angles for larger deflection. Then why didn't you?
We think that for larger deflection, it can be used for more extensive things. But we think, we only talk about smart deflection for our own experiment.
Okay, so. For the damping graphs,
yes.
You can see that the amplitude is decreasing, but not at a linear rate. Can you explain?
So I would like to talk about how the reporter reported. So first, talking about the observation video, the reporter showed a great observation by summarizing by clearly showing the phenomenon. But the reporter lacked explanation about the observation video and how to predict further theories. And about the parameters, the reporter suggests the leaf springs and the magnets and the length between the magnets and the base. So I think that he explained his parameters well, but he lacked discussion of changing initial angles and then the bending angle changing when adding like magnets, and also the center of mass changing also. So the theory, the reporter used the bending angle and then the simple harmonic motion system and also the coupled oscillating. So the reporter did a good job on explaining his theory, but he lacked some explanation of the function and the friction produced during the motion. And then for the experiments, he had very well understanding images and explained the graphs clearly, but there were no quantitative comparison between his theoretical and corresponding results. And also, he lacked to make the experiments more precise. And so later I want to discuss questions with the opponents. So can we continue to the next page? So I want to continue by asking your standpoint.
I remember you asked that is why it's not a linear state. And I think my explanation to this is that because of the many different resistant forces, it will not always be to a single constant by the power to 1. So that means that it will decline in a curve manner.
But by declining in a curve manner, does it ever come to a stop?
Yes, it does come to a stop in the end, but it does slowly come to a stop when the energy is all affected by the resistance.
So may I ask you, is it a complete stop?
From eyesight, we could see that it's almost like a stop, but maybe
so you can't come to a quantitative conclusion if it is a stop.
Yes. No. It, we think it will go close to a stop, but it will never go to a complete stop, like as we can see.
Right. And what I wanted to ask you is, first, what points did you track using tracking?
We didn't use tracker. We used from the data points in the graph. We used a sensor to track the.
Okay, so
we didn't really track. It's just the red light, and when we used to test the distance between the viewer and the sensor.
Yes, so in your data, is there somehow that you can define what is when you can conclude your graph? So your graph, you only showed your graph at an extent of time,
yes.
At a range of time, but further, will there still be motion?
Yes, we still observe small motion from the sensor.
So is the further motion still the same as how you predicted?
Yes, I think we see it as the same as the part of the second set of.
And can you tell me, when it comes to that very small motion, how did you predict and how did you see it?
We still, because the graph, because after we put in the graph, because the amplitude is small, but when we amplify, we can see that it still has the same motion. And that's, so we can use the same mechanic that we use to determine the plot.
Okay, so the opponent thinks that you can actually quantize your graphs and data by coming to a point like if your amplitude is below, like let's say 0.5 centimeters or 0.5 millimeters, then you can conclude your motion. And that would be more precise than using your eyes.
But like, we did come, because like, so like, we think, concluded the experiment at like similar to what you said. When the amplitude seems to be increasing at a certain amount, we stop, we cut the graph. So that's why we only show this part of the graph, because the graph on the when it keeps going, it will go to what we said, like a stop of the
amplitude. And speaking about amplitude, do you think the two magnets had the same or different amplitude?
Okay. What?
The same, the two different magnets. Here and here.
Yes, it has the same.
Do you think they have the same or different amplitude?
Amplitude. We think that they will experience the second will experience common amplitude due to the energy loss.
And where is the energy loss?
Energy loss between the magnets, because no matter if it is because of small friction or air drag, it will cause a small energy loss between the two instruments.
So in your theory, you said that coupling oscillations have a transfer of energy.
Yes.
But in your experiment, there is actually a loss of energy while transferring.
Yes.
Then, can you give me an amount or percentage of how much energy is lost by using your graphs?
At first we tried to do it, but it's hard to quantify the very small lost amount of energy. So at the end, we didn't get come to a precise percentage.
Can you use your amplitudes to calculate energy?
Yes.
Then, can you use your different amplitudes to, like for both, when you show your both spring, can you use your amplitudes to calculate energy and to show how it will behave?
Yes, and that's how we show it.
Then I'm pretty sure that you can calculate numbers and calculate
it is, yes, of course.
Then can you actually tell me a little bit more
about the presentation?
Yes.
It's not, you haven't quantified that yet.
Okay. For your theory, did you have a theoretical model?
Theoretical model, yes. My theoretical model was based on first simple harmonic motion, second is the coupled oscillator.
And for the simple harmonic motion, most of the time we can derive it as F equals negative kx, then where do I see this equation?
Because, as I said in the presentation, it is not solely simple harmonic motion, because if it's simple harmonic motion, it will look something like this. And if it's not a simple harmonic motion.
But for simple harmonic motion,
yes.
We can derive a k, is that correct?
You mean the constant?
Yes. Then, from that constant, can we derive periods?
Periods. From that constant, can we derive periods? Yes.
So, do you think that the period is remaining a constant?
The period, this is controlling the time, and the period is determined by the constant right A right here.
So, you think that the period is a constant?
Yes, I think that.
Then, can we skip to the page that you had your experimental results showing your period? Your graph. So here, you can actually see that your period is actually expanding a little bit. From your line distance.
Oh, you mean like the front is different from the neck?
Yes.
I'm very happy to hear that from you. I will try to be discussing is that I think that the thing that causes this, the difference in the period is that because we see that in the end, you can see that the distance or the length between the lines that we determine as energy transfer is nearly the same period as 2.388. But the front, it has a smaller period, which we determine that because of the first set of motions causing the period to be different from the second set of motions.
So do you mean that your period is changing or not?
if you're talking about the static, like the static motion, then the static part of the oscillation, I would say yes.
Okay. So, what do you think the errors are then?
Error. I think that is the question that I'm trying to answer here, is that I determined that as not an error is because of the different motions causing different periods. So that means that if we only look at the second set of motions, then it will become like the from here on, and then we can see that the period is much of a constant. So we don't think that is a part of an error.
So you don't think that any other factors will cause period decrease throughout time?
From the statistics, I think the period are really the same. So I think that from what we can see, there are either the resistance are very small, or there is no resistance, so all in the period will be the same.
So I want to ask you about the parameter of changing the magnitudes. Changing the magnitudes. So did you change except for like and
yes, we did try to change the magnets in between, but because of the resistance, we found out that it's unable to do it with our assumption. So we at the end we stick to the one magnet. Yes.
So then I want to ask if somehow that you could stick two magnets for both
yes.
here, would the center of mass change?
Yes, I think because the magnet has its own weight,
yes.
So we need the center of mass will also.
So, will the center of mass affect your bending angle?
Bending angle. Oh, you mean like my oscillate?
Yes.
Oh. I think that because we did, when we moved the magnet at different locations on the ruler. So, for example, if we put the magnet up here, the center of mass is more upwards. And if we put the
magnet, I want to ask you about the bending angle.
Oh, the bending angle will be smaller. If the cinematic is down here, but the cinematic is up here, then the bending angle will increase.
So if your bending angle will decrease due to putting more magnets, then
if the center of mass is down here, but if we put more magnets on the top, that means the center of mass will move up, so we're causing a larger oscillation.
Okay then. When causing larger oscillations, does that exceed your 5-degree assumption?
Yeah, so that's why we didn't.
Can I ask you theoretically?
Theoretically.
Yes. If I change the magnet amounts and I use your equation, exceeding 5 degrees.
Yes.
Can you give me your results?
Result. Because we theoretical results.
Yes.
We think that if we control the angle of this bending at 5 degrees, smaller than 5 degrees, this angle will still be smaller than 5 degrees because the energy will be lost in between. But the bending angle will be larger than if we only put one magnet here.
So you're saying that the bending angle will increase, but then it will decrease to your 5 degrees.
The bending angle are all smaller than the first.
Then I want to ask
wait,
you.
Wait, time is up. Yeah, lesson summarized.
I want to conclude by saying that the reporter didn't have a very precise experimental setup. So first, he used his hand to control the initial angle, which I think isn't very appropriate, and second, he didn't show how he puts those two rulers, since they do look a little bit slanted. And then he discussed only focus on the ruler length, since he uses 5 degrees as a reason to not consider other parameters. And the good thing about the presentation is that there are very clear images and graphs to support the prediction. So his graphs about the decay of energy and transfer are very clear and lacking quantitative numbers.
Okay, question from reviewer.
So for the reporter, will the resonance of the base, please do the setup change. So will the resonance of the base affect the complete motion?
We didn't do a fair amount of that, but we think that it will more or less affect the motion.
And you think it will affect the
vibrating motion? Do think that the base will affect the motion.
So don't you think that we should separate it into two systems so that these both vibrating will not, the resonance of each vibrating will not affect the ladder one.
Can you say?
So don't you think that we should separate the string into two different systems so that the resonance of the base will not affect the other one when you only cause this vibrating?
We did calculate them both differently, separately. We didn't. We only just snap the graph together, but we look at them separately.
But when you change one's releasing angle, it causes vibration and it causes the resonance of the base. So when you're measuring this part, it might change the motion of this vibration.
Because you can see that we actually have a thing to stick the base together, so we actually fix the base so that the effect won't be as.
Okay, thank you. So in only changing one vibrating, one string vibrating, can you explain about the energy distribution of the part?
A bit of the energy will be transferred to this due to the repulsion of the magnet, and after that, then this will feature an elastic acceleration, and then this will.
Okay. So, what are factors that causes the damping inside the system?
I think that the repulsion force can cause the damping.
Does it the air drag and the friction? The damping of the vibration.
Yes, I think the resistance forces will be a part.
So do you agree with that?
I do agree that resistance forces do affect the damping motion, but I do think that there are a lot of more variables.
So for a reporter, can you give a case where you track the motion of the lead springs? So what parameters do you think will affect the frequency of the wave? Like this frequency, that it's sparser or not?
We didn't do a experiment on that, but I think that the resistance or the magnet amount will affect the period.
And do you agree with that?
Yes.
Or are there other parameters that you think will also affect the motion?
You mean the frequency distribution?
Yes.
I think that's the rod length and then the magnetic force.
Okay. For the reporter, how did you define the effective length of the string?
Effective
length means that which part of the springs will be affected by the repelling force?
I think a whole spring will have that.
And do you agree with that? You
yes.
think the whole spring will have it will be affected?
Yes.
Okay, thank you.
On Wojuri's fellow competitors, this is a review from Team Excel here, reviewing problem number 6, magnetic mechanical oscillator. Problem statement. Secure the lure ends of 2 identical leaf springs to a non-magnetic base and attach magnets to upper ends such that they repel and are free to move. Investigate how the movement of the springs depend on relevant parameters. Due to the problem statement, I believe that we should focus on why the springs have the coupling motion and how the oscillating frequency changes in different parameters, and what condition makes the coupling motion most significant. These are the review of the report. First, for his phenomenon part, he had demonstrated an observation video about the coupling motion. And he separated it into different phases for the qualitative explanation. Also talked about the movement of 2 different strings. And his theory regards the simple harmonic motion and bending angle in coupling oscillators. And he conducted experiment parameters including the distance between the leaf strings and the length of the leaf strings. And these are pros and cons that I think the reporter had. First of all, he had a clear observation video and an illustration for the motion. And he demonstrated the phenomenon and separated it into different stages so that we can understand the phenomenon more thoroughly. However, he did not compare between the theory and experiments for his experiment data. And he did explain about a few binary limitations and using Arduino to clearly record the motion for his setup. And in this part, I agree with the Arduino part so that I can track the motion of the string more accurately. However, I do suggest that the reporter not using hands for the releasing method and also try to separate the two leaf springs into 2 different systems so that one's vibrating will not cause the resonance of the bass and affect the another spring's vibrating. And he didn't measure the ear drag and he cannot give a prediction for the percentage that energy dissipation. And for the review of the opponent, he considered the amount of the magnets will change the center of mass and pointed out the methods how the reported experiment results has problems. And he did not ask three points towards the reporter, and he did not focus on the physics inside behind the phenomena. And this part, I believe that they should discuss on the repel force that, and also the effective length in the system. For the first key discussion about energy dissipation, the opponent asks, what is the reason that causes the energy dissipation in the system? Well, the reporter answered, air drag and the small friction. I partially agree with the reporter, since I also believe air drag is the main reason that causes the dissipation. However, the reporter cannot provide a quantitative result about the air drag, which in this part I suggest the reporter for using a fitting constant for measuring the damping and the periodic time to get a fitting constant. And I asked, will the resonance of the reporter's affect the motion? The reporter said fixed base will decrease the variation. And the opponent answered, your resonance will affect the system. And in this part, I believe that it's possible since the fixed space won't help. The reporter should compare the result about magnets on the leaf springs. And next, I also asked, what parameters do you think will affect the frequency of the wave? And I believe that this is what I meant, frequency. I think the length of leaf springs and magnitude will affect the result as it takes longer experiments for the oscillation. For your points, I believe that the energy transition causes one of the most significant effects the motion the most. However, did not discuss too much about the energy transition inside the system. In this part, I believe it can separate into kinetic energy of leaf springs and magnets and elastic energy of the leaf springs. However, he did not discuss about the width of the beats and frequency of the waves and amplitude of the waves, which a problem statement is asking for the characteristics of these. Thank
you. Concluding remarks from
the reporter. Thank you the reviewer and the opponent for this amazing discussion. And so now I'll be making some concluding remarks. So first, we investigated the distance of the magnet and the base, and the distance between the two strings. Experimentally verify how these parameters affect the phenomenon. Second, we concluded that the frequency is higher when the when the length of the base of the magnet is shorter. And I think the future improvement that we can do is add other parameters, like a larger angle. And secondly, we can quantify the data about the concluded motion and energy loss. And thirdly, we think we can impair our theoretical model by adding air drag into a fitting constant into our theoretical model. Fourthly, we think we can include the deviation of the analysis. And I think that's my
about the changing in the frequency. So if your model from recoupling is linear at this spring, so there will be a change in the frequency of the beaming? If your model were based on the linear, linear relation, which is spring, right? In this case, would there be a change of the beating frequency?
I'm not sure about this answer.
So how about the
can I ask what's the last part of the question?
You've been discussed about the change of the beating frequency. So if the model was based on an ideal spring coupling model, which means the force is related to the displacement difference. In this case, would the beating frequency change?
So if the force changes while the oscillation happens, then I do think that it will affect.
I believe that in this case, the energy distribution is because when the R2 is having the greater energy part, then the other string has the less energy for this part. And this is why they consider the theory as under this circumstance. And however, I believe that if you consider it linear, it will also affect the theory line, the motion for the depth wave. Or the frequency, sorry.
Question.
For report, we turn to page 14. Yeah, so you set up here.
Yes.
Just want to clarify what are these two?
The D is the, we have, because we set these two, right here, these sensors.
So not magnets.
Although they're not magnets. Okay. Sorry for the misunderstanding.
I have a question for three of you. If you consider that your results like a beating frequency, what parameter will affect this beating frequency
I think the beating frequency will be affected by many parameters, which I think some of them could be the magnetic force, and the second I think is the material of the ruler and the length of the ruler, and I think if the base is fixed or not will also affect the baking frequency.
Okay.
I think that's the magnetic force, which is the magnets, and then the placement of the magnet to affect the ruler length. And so if the ruler length is like this or the magnet is placed here, it will affect the frequency too. And also the texture of the ruler.
So I believe that this is between the two springs will cause the repel force to be different, so it will affect. And also the length of the spring will cause the effective length to be different, which I believe that not all the spring will have this effect. It should have an effective length that only this part will change the vibration. And so it will also affect the fitting constant inside this part.
Any questions
from Jerry? Have you ever really solved the copper oscillator solution?
Have we ever
solving the copper oscillation?
No, we haven't tried. We haven't done the solving one.
So, x field mu, the nonlinear term in this case, what would be the effect of the nonlinear term?
I think it might affect the damping effect, and it might affect the period of the oscillation as well.
The linear term of the oscillation. Because assuming the linear, then the frequency is fixed for the oscillation. For nonlinear, the frequency will change. So what do you think if you consider the nonlinear effect? Because the magnetic battery is nonlinear,
yes.
And when you enter to the block, it's also nonlinear.
So what
would you contribute to your data?
I think because of the difference in the magnetic force at different place displacements, I think that it will affect about the mainly affect about our forces, which will mainly affect our energy transfer part and will affect the periodic motion.
If a nonlinear trend is occurring here, then I think the coupling oscillation will be affected, and it will change the period and the frequency fitting.
Sorry, I'm not able to provide a direct relation between the linear and also how the characteristics of the vibration, but I believe it does cause impact on the frequency, and also if it's sparser or not, and also the oscillation.
Okay, thank you. Now for story.
Yeah.
Okay, if there